Your lecture and she's heard of mine. Pleasure to introduce Professor Jennie Henley, who needs no introduction, not least because, as the RNCM's Director of Programmes, is well known to you all, but also because Jennie's going to be introducing herself as part of her talk as well. It's really exciting to me to be in an institution that's part of research that directly impacts on policy, and I'm really excited to hear more about this research in detail now. Jennie, thank you.
Thank you. Anybody who's seen me speak or teach will know this is really difficult to stay still in one place as I'm speaking, but I need to for the microphone for the live stream. So, yes, I'm Director of Programmes here, as you all know or may not know, varying degrees of what I do. And my role involves looking at the portfolio of programmes, junior programmes, all of our junior work, undergraduate, postgraduate, taught work. So my background is in music education. I've taught for a long time, mainly teaching the flute, classroom teaching as well, ensemble direction, working with both youth ensembles and amateur ensembles. Over the past 17 years or so, I used to say 15 years, but now it's crept up to 17 years, so I've been researching the relationship between pedagogy and inclusion. And I didn't really set out to research that. That wasn't what I started out doing. I started by looking at the deep learning processes involved in adult ensembles. I was involved with an adult learning programme back in 2001, it launched, that was about giving opportunities to adults who had not had opportunities as children to learn to play instruments. It was done through a band method, and I was really fascinated by the progress that was made using that method. And so I started my research life really understanding the learning processes in that environment. And through that research, it took me to looking at musical identity, the way adults identified either as a musician or not a musician, and really important to be able to say, no, I'm not a musician, but that's another story for another day, perhaps. And how adults use their identities in their learning and the role of performance in the learning process. So through that research, part of it, I learned to play Javanese gamelan. That was an autoethnographic strand of my research to understand myself and to look at my own learning processes in a fairly unusual musical setting. And that took me on a research journey where I came into contact with Good Vibrations, a charity who takes Javanese gamelan into prisons, and started a sequence of research studies looking at learning processes that lead to all of the various different reported positive outcomes as a result of engaging in music in different challenging circumstances. Researched at primary schools, looking at generalist teachers who teach music. But the connection with all of the research that I've carried out is this real relationship between pedagogy and inclusion. What is it in the learning that either leads to feelings of inclusion or leads to exclusionary practice? So, that's a little bit of background to my research history. What's really interesting to me at the moment is the alignment of policy. There's something very fascinating going on with policy at the moment, which I'll show you in a moment, that's presenting some key opportunities, but also presenting there's some real threats in that policy alignment too. Now, what's great about my role here, what I really love about the connection between my role and my research, is I can take all of this body of research, I can use it to look at strategy, look at what we're doing here, and put things into practice. So it's the relationship between the policy gazing that I have to do as part of my role, looking and seeing what's coming up and understanding how that impacts our work here, the research work that I do, and then writing strategy and implementing things that will move and change and take things forward. So what I'm going to do today, this evening, this afternoon, is I'm going to talk for maybe about 20 minutes or so, and I'm going to outline the policy context, the policy landscape, and I'm going to just present a little bit of the key findings from some research that I did a couple of years ago looking at the barriers to music education, and then consider how that is underpinning strategy. And then I've got a lovely panel of some wonderful lower six, year 12, 16, 17 year old A-level students, and we're going to have a conversation. We're going to have a chat. I'm going to have a chat to them about their responses to what I've presented and just think about their experiences, and then we'll open up for questions. Okay, so here's the policy context. Hold on to your seats. Now, many of you know this context already, so the 23rd of November, those of you who sit on various committees that I sit on will have heard this numerous times, so 23rd of November 2021, there was a letter from the Secretary of State for Education, Minister for Higher and Further Education, to the Office of Students to set out a new direction of travel for access and participation. So this letter indicated a move away from the hard targets that all higher education institutions are expected to set and meet that are about recruitment, retention and employment for five categories of students. So this is first generation students, so those who are coming from families who've never been to university before, those experiencing multiple deprivation, ethnicity, disability, and mature students. And that's the sort of regime that we've been working in. Taking things into a new direction of travel and thinking about disadvantage in a different way. Now there's a really critical sentence in that letter. I'll just read this out. So providers, that's us, should be given full credit for activities that support students onto other positive outcomes, including apprenticeships, vocational education, and access to other universities, not solely judged on increasing access to their own institution. So our work that we have done to widen access has had to meet these really hard targets, and it's been about recruitment to us, to our institution. Well, that has now lifted. I'll come back to that in a moment. It might seem like a small change, but it's incredibly significant. Okay, so then on the 12th of April this year, we all had a request to vary our access and participation plans to address four new priorities. So the four new priorities for higher education, access and participation, to make plans more accessible. If anybody's read them, they're really not accessible. Priority B, now this is critical, develop, enhance and expand partnerships with schools and other local and national organisations to help raise pre-16 attainment. Priority C is all about high quality courses and good graduate outcomes to sort of make sure that we can get students into, have really, really good degree experiences. And priority D, seek to develop more diverse pathways into and through higher education. Now, there's a number of things on there that might raise red flags to people. There's a number of opportunities. But I'm going to focus on priority B mainly for this presentation. So we submitted our variation to our access and participation plan in July, being assessed at the moment. But in February, we're going to have to rewrite it. The Office for Students have just launched a consultation on the new access and participation plans, and they're moving to a risk-based approach. So there will be some kind of national risk register. We don't know what that looks like yet. And we have to identify the risks specific to us, to our institution. And then we have to put in interventions to mitigate those risks. And then we have to evaluate it. And the evaluation is both process evaluation, so understanding the process of what we're doing, whether it works or not, and understanding why not it works, and also impact evaluation. So, there's a really interesting policy. This is the policy alignment that I'm talking about, because this is higher education policy. Have I put the right slide in the right place? Oh no, hang on, there we go. This is higher education policy aligning with other educational policy and cultural policy. I can see something different to you. Can you see my slides moving?
No, not moving.
They're not moving. Okay. Oh, well, you don't really need to see it. It's just so you've got something to look at. Okay. All right. Lovely. By the way, this is a dyslexic-friendly colour. If anybody's sitting there thinking, why she put it on yellow, it looks great to me. So, the policy alignment, the slide that you can't see. So, higher education, this move for access and participation towards working in partnership with schools to raise attainment, focusing on pre-16. And there's a lot of discourse surrounding multi-academy trusts with that, and there's a real push from the Office for Students for universities to work with multi-academy trusts. And in education policy, there's a real push for multi-academy trusts. I'm smiling at the back because I know we have somebody from a multi-academy trust here. So there's a real push in education policy to move to multi-academy trusts, to clusters of school, sharing resources, etc., etc. The music education policy, the new national plan for music education, if you read that carefully, multi-academy trusts appear in that quite a lot, but also the way higher education is being positioned in music education is interesting, because the National Plan for Music Education now includes this higher education through into the profession, and there will be a realignment of positioning of schools, HE, all sorts of music education organisations within that to try and understand and realise, you know, what that means. And then in cultural policy, so I was chatting to Manus this morning about the MPO announcement that was meant to be today and has now been delayed. But if you look at the Arts Council Let's Create strategy, and if you look at the relationship framework, inclusion, diversity is really key, and organisations have to monitor and report, and their funding is contingent on meeting the requirements laid out for them in their funding agreements. So this is kind of creating a bit of an opportunity, because some things are aligning. So if you're working in higher education, you've been given the ability to work with schools and to work in music education that doesn't have to be about recruitment to your own institution, which is quite emancipating, because it means that we can really do some very meaningful work in music education. But there are also some real key risks to this policy alignment. As one of those, you can't see them. Oh, there it is. How weird. Okay. Ah, there we go, lovely. Maybe it was just having a moment. Okay, so there's some real key risks. There's a number of different risks, and you know, you really do need to look into the detail of the policy to sort of find and understand these. Well, the first thing that springs to mind is that we're in danger of flooding the market. The music education landscape is very fragile already. It's a marketplace. We're all fighting for the same bit of funding. And if we're not careful, if a whole load of university music departments go into schools and say, hey, we can help with your school curriculum, that's going to create a lot of tensions. But we've got to work with the music education landscape that already exists, and that's going to take a lot of care and a lot of really key strategic thinking to do so. The second key risk that I can see is the danger, if we're not careful, we could perhaps, without knowing it, argue the case for music to be outside of the curriculum. So the Office for Students are very clear that where higher education can make the best contribution is in extracurricular work. And if you take away that extracurricular work from the teacher, you're kind of in danger of shrinking the workforce. So anybody who's, you know, worked in classroom teaching, you teach your year nines on Monday morning because you know you've got a school choir on a Friday. It's really important for you to be doing that work. And if we enter into a kind of music education landscape where that work is solely done by other people and you're not involved in that work, there's potential that people might think, actually, I don't really want to be a class teacher, I want to do this, and they might leave the workforce. But also there's a real danger, I think, from the kind of events and things that I've been to for the Office for Students, the way that they're talking. You think, oh, this is really difficult, you're seeing music solely as an extracurricular activity and not really, this isn't really about curriculum. So we need to watch that. That's something that, you know, people like me need to watch out for. And the third risk are the pedagogical tensions. So there's different epistemological starting points, different understandings of how you're building knowledge, and different pedagogical approaches in different phases of learning. And without that really detailed understanding of pedagogy and education, there's a real danger that people meaning well might go in and really, really disrupt the learning of the students that they're working with. And it's really important that when working in education environments, you've got that deep, detailed understanding of pedagogy, of educational processes, understanding the schools, understanding how schools operate, and working with schools. Otherwise, you get this real tension where, you know, the musicians are the people coming into the school and they're not really part of the school, and it can be very fragmented. Okay, right. So, how do we mitigate these risks? You're all asking, I'm sure. So, I say the best way that we can work to mitigate this, and there are a lot more, you know, when you start looking at the detail, there's you know, there's a lot more things that you think, oh, that might be really tricky if we don't do that right. I think that we need to look to educational research to really understand and underpin the strategies that we're using. So why educational research? Why not any other type of research? So those of you that work in educational research will be familiar with Biesta's work. He's, and if you're interested in education, read some Biesta. He's absolutely great. And he articulates the difference between education research and other types of research. And what's really crucial is that educational research asks the educational questions. So we ask what education is. What is music education? What is the value of music education? Who is music education for? That's a really important question. And so this sort of asking these epistemological questions, the ontological questions, ultimately it's about how can we make education better, coming from this the sort of really unpicking the processes, the values, the policy. So the sort of policy gazing, if you like, and the real detailed understanding of what happens in the classroom come together, and you use those to understand the educational context and develop ways of moving forward. Okay, so that leads me on to a snippet of research. So the research I'm going to present a little bit of, yeah, here we go. It's going to appear. Okay, so it was part of the Music Commission. So the Music Commission was funded by the Arts Council, and it was 2017 for 18 months. What the Music Commission did was brought together a panel of all sorts of different people from across the music profession, research, and music education to try and understand the barriers to music education. And so we had a research program. The first thing that we did is we collected field notes over 12 months, you can see there, to really understand the field, identify the stakeholders, steer the research program. So we had lots and lots of meetings, we went along to the Music Commission meetings, made lots of notes to really think about who this research was for and what it was that we were trying to do. Then we did some empirical work. We had a survey and focus group. So you can see 513 responses to our survey, and there were 29 focus groups with 203. In total, 10 of those 29 focus groups were solely young people. And we had young people contribute to the survey as well. So a total of 716. So that's a small study. So we did a small study. But then what we did is we also did a rapid evidence assessment, and don't be fooled, it is not rapid. It usually takes at least 6 months, but it's a very systematic methodology. So you set the protocol, that's what the field notes led into, and then you do a very systematic search, you have inclusion criteria which you then apply to just kind of like draw down the key pieces of literature that you want to use. It's a very systematic way of reviewing all the literature. Our inclusion criteria are things such as must have been published in the last 5 years, because that tallied in with the introduction of the old National Plan for Music Education, must be in the English context, because that was the context that we were looking at, etc., etc. And in the evidence that we gathered together from that evidence assessment, there were 10,000 research participants. So that represented the wider the wider field. So what we did is we did an inductive analysis. I can see people glazing over as I'm talking research methodology. We did an inductive analysis where we induced the themes from the small study. Drew those themes out, and then we applied those to the evidence, the wider body of research. So then we did a deductive analysis, the wider body of research, to find the agreement. And then we drew out a list of themes that were in agreement with each other. And these themes were, eight themes. Funding ran all the way through, but there were also some very specific things related to funding that we drew out as a theme together. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to present a little bit of this, because there's an awful lot of data actually here that we collected. I'm going to talk a little bit about pupil and participant voice. I'm going to talk a little bit about location. Diversity and inclusion had a number of sub-themes, and location was one of those. I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about collaboration, and I'm going to talk about transition points. Now, all of these themes, they all intersect. It's really interesting to see the sort of, you know, the stories that go through. But I'm just going to focus very quickly on those. Pupil and participant voice is really striking, actually. That was one of the key themes that came through. Is that going to come up? Yeah, I've just put a couple of quotes on the slides. So the things that came up here were the critique of having a top-down policy approach. You know, there was you need to start listening to young people and stop decisions being made by adults who think they know best. You know, this came through really, really strongly, particularly from the young people's focus groups. There was data that pointed to lack of agency for young people to set their own goals and musical pathways. That was seen as a barrier to their own progress in music education. They were talking about teaching that switches them off, lack of learner-centred approaches, lack of dialogue between stakeholders, so schools not talking to music services, not talking to other organisations, etc. And this was seen as a barrier. And really importantly, what we saw is that the responses that came through from young people show that they've got a lot to contribute to the debate, a lot. And quite often they're just kind of put over there, and that's really lovely, this is what the young people said, but we can see that they were very articulate and very sensible. Okay, so location, as the subcategory of diversity and inclusion, you can imagine the sort of things that are coming up here. There was a lot of talk about London-centric opportunities, but there's a contradiction here as well, because there were talk about London-centric opportunities only actually happening in certain places in London. And the data that came from outer London was really clear that there was a lack of opportunity in some places, even though they're classed as part of the same thing. Actually, the boroughs are very, very different. Distance to travel, that came up, and transport, slow internet speed, which is interesting because this was pre-pandemic, right? So this finished kind of maybe just before the pandemic, I guess. So even then, people were using remote learning techniques, but slow internet speed was a problem. Limited pool of good teachers in areas. So these are things that came through the data. Collaboration. So the sorts of things that came up here, where hubs are working, they're working really well, and there's a really good provision and really good opportunities. But where they're not working well, the provision's very fragmented. And that really came through the data. It also came through the data that there's a feeling that there's a national fragmentation. There's no overarching body that represents music education, because actually music education isn't one thing. And there's a feeling that it's really, really separated out. There was some really interesting data related to hubs and things that suggested that the problems can arise when hubs try to do everything, but also when they have too strong a voice in things. So the hub wants to do X, and they've got the strongest voice, so X happens regardless of what this organisation over here wants to do, what this organisation over here wants to do. It's really interesting to see that data. And there was a lot of interesting talk about the need for greater collaboration with higher education, interesting, in relation to the changes to HE policy, and also greater collaboration with professionals. Now, we know that there's some really fantastic work that goes on here, but it's, again, very, very pocketed. And the people who participated in the survey were perhaps not seeing this or not accessing this. And then finally, transition and progression points. So transition has been a problem. The primary secondary transition has always been problematic for all sorts of reasons. There's lots of research on that you can read if you want to. what's really interesting with the advent of wider opportunities is there's a new transition point that is problematic, and that's the transition from those initial wider opportunity experiences into further study and further progression. Some places have got it right and they can do it really, really well, but a lot of places really haven't, and large organisations are struggling with this. They're getting many, many children into their sort of like initial 2-3 year ensemble programmes, but not a great deal of progression out of that. It's a real problem. Oh, this is really heartbreaking. I've not changed the slide. That bottom quote there, the fact that actually quite a lot of children know that they've only got a year, and parents know that they've only got a year of free learning, then they're going to have to pay. So, you know, they know it's not going to go on from the start. That's so, you know, that's really, really, some of the data that came through was actually really difficult to read when you're hearing these stories of parents talking about their kids and they really wanted to do this, but they only had a year and then it stopped, and now they think that that's it forever. They can't access music anymore because they've had their one opportunity. That's really difficult, and we need to listen to that. The pedagogical transition from that ensemble tuition to one-to-one learning is difficult, and it needs to be managed really, really well and planned for really well. And often what we saw is that when people had progressed out of these schemes, it was through private tuition, not through any school provision or any music service provision. So parents have paid for private tuition in order for their kids to continue. Lack of consistency in these wider opportunities programmes and large ensembles programmes. Lack of follow-up activities. The primary-secondary transition came up. And also moving between schools was interesting. There was some very interesting data from people who've moved schools in the middle of the same school year and found such a difference of opportunity in one school that they're in to the next school that they're in. So this research I've published, hopefully you've read it, in a paper called Time for Change. What really struck me looking at this research, and probably strikes you, you're probably sitting there thinking, why is she telling us this? We already know this. That's the point. That is the point. The Music Commission, I think, were quite disappointed that we hadn't found the missing link, the big, you know, the new thing. But actually, what this is telling me, that at 20 years after the introduction of wider opportunities programmes, so a very clear policy initiative in order to specifically address barriers to access, address CPD, address a whole range of things, and in the paper I've just kind of bullet pointed it at the beginning, 20 years later the same barriers still exist. Yet there's been a tranche, there's been research and evaluation throughout the past 20 years that have shown the same barriers still exist. So if we really do want things to change, and if we really, really do want to give opportunities to young people that don't currently have them, we've got to do something different. We have to. So those of you who are very close to the work here, the strategy that I've put together, actually what I've done is I've taken, this is why I presented those four things, I've taken those four themes, the partnership, collaboration and presence voice, etc., and use those to create a strategy. So there's very clear research that's showing that these are the barriers, so we need to do something strategic in order to specifically address those barriers. Now, I'm not going to bore you to death with the whole strategy, but the strategy for the Engage Education work here is built on four strategic drivers. So everything we do is quality, everything we do. And what's really interesting, another piece of research that I did just before this one actually about excellence and inclusion, is quality is contextual. It's contingent, it means different things to different people depending on what you do. But we know that the work that we're doing is quality, and we must do it in partnership. That's so important. Gone are the days of the institution saying, we have the knowledge and we're going to give it to you. we've turned that around, and we turned it around in our pilot Engage Brass work, where we went out to organisations, grassroots organisations, said, well, what do you want us to do? And we put in a programme in place that was what they actually wanted us to do. It was really interesting how that worked. But that partnership is crucial, because if we're ever going to get over that fragmentation, we have to work in partnership. Visibility is really key in lots of different ways. Visibility here within our own institution, visibility of the institution outside, and visibility of the opportunities for the young people. And then it has to be underpinned by research. It really does, because that's how we really know and understand what is happening, and can ask those educational questions. Is it working? Why is it working? Who is it working for? That is such a great question. We constantly have to ask, who are we doing this for? It's really important. But also, this work is research generating, isn't it? So we can understand more about what we're doing. And then we've got five areas of work. The key focus this year is on young people's voice. Ding, ding, ding. Nice segue into my lovely young people sat here. Young people's voice. So we're working to set up a youth council to really put in some proper youth governance. And we really need to, we do value our young people, we do value their voices, but we've got to really, really listen to them. So I thought what I would do, what would be interesting, is to just have a chat to some lovely A-level students to see what their responses are to these barriers, and to talk about them, their experiences. And I've got Henri, Emma and Adam sat down here waiting patiently to have a chat. Do you want to come and sit down? Yeah, here we go. Lovely. Now I'm hoping that these microphones will pick it up on the live stream. Great. Lovely. Hello. Nice to see you. Okay. Hi. Everybody's all friendly. You know, well, some of you know some people, some of you don't know some people. So we're three lovely people, interestingly, all with completely different school backgrounds. So somebody from state school, somebody from private school, and somebody who's homeschooled, with different musical interests. So tell me, we had a chat beforehand anyway, didn't we? And just looking at those things related to location and collaboration transition, what are your sort of immediate thoughts? What springs to mind?
I mean, I would say definitely the research that's being done currently. I feel like that's almost vital to the progression of music education in its current form, because a lot of the times, I mean, I come from a sort of home educator background. College is my first experience of state school in general, and it's sort of half a shock, should you say, because my experience of school is literally what other people have told me, and that sort of whole point of listening to young people doesn't happen at all. So I feel like the research being done into that and how it can affect music education is quite vital, because there's a lot of points not even just in music A level, but in other subjects. So I feel like it could be expanded and improved simply just by listening to what the students have to say about it. Mm-hmm. And it's definitely sort of an interesting thing I do want to see progress.
I didn't pay you to say that research is No, that's really interesting that your experience at school comes from what people have told you about.
Something else important is knowing where, like, music as like a classroom subject fits into music education, and where music is like an instrumental lesson, how extracurricular comes into it. Because experience with like music as like a subject at school is very different to experience with music as a outside of school thing that I study in my own time.
Tell me a little bit more about that.
Which I develop with music in the classroom, and music is.
Well, that's interesting, isn't it, that you're seeing those as two different things?
Mm-hmm. Because, well, originally, like beginning of secondary school, when I first studied music, that was like how I mostly learned stuff about music. As I went on and studied stuff more independently, it's gone to the point where music as a subject, classroom subject, is almost limiting to me.
Mm-hmm. Limiting in what way? That's interesting.
Well, first of all, like, we did, like, in because beginning of sixth form, we're doing a bunch of theory stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And this is theory stuff I've drilled into myself years before, you know, so it's stuff I already know how to do, like that. So for me, it's limiting because this time and lesson that everyone, because people come into sixth form at different points, so obviously there's somebody that time is spent doing virtually nothing in terms of improvement, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, really interesting. Might come back to something around in a minute. Anyway, we've got anything you want to
add? I definitely agree with that extracurricular part because I was educated outside of school, for example, secondary school, and a lot of my theory knowledge came from that, and then doing GCSE was sort of, I feel like if you hadn't had extracurricular knowledge, you wouldn't have been able to do very well, mm-hmm. just because teaching is difficult to understand in such a short period of time if you haven't had help outside of school.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So tell me about your opportunities that you've had outside of school then. So you're all brilliant musicians. So how have you got there?
I mean, obviously June is for me.
So you're a JRNCM?
JRNCM, yeah. That's huge on for me.
What did that open up for you?
Well, it's more so like, because at juniors you get taught as if it's like a conservatoire, it's just that, you know, for younger people, if that makes sense. You get taught and you have like, when you're juniors, people like give you like respect of a musician rather than a young person. Like, there's musical maturity there, if that makes sense. And being in that environment of like, being respected as a musician and not like feeling like people are trying to dumb stuff down to you or something like that, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. It's interesting that idea that you're being treated as a musician and you are a musician and you're,
yeah.
there's respect there for it. Yeah, lovely. I wonder what you were saying.
I would say my first sort of opening to music education, should you say, was more of community music with an organisation called Brighter Sound. Mm-hmm. And that, like, I was self-taught piano, still am, don't have lessons. But as I picked up other instruments, I did have lessons there, and that was sort of help with the music theory aspects. But the actual first delve into music as like being a musician and considering it as a career and things like that was this program run by Brighter Sound, and it's quite interesting looking back at it because it is very much so taken on a music facilitation standpoint. They're not teaching you. And they're not just going, do whatever you want, they're guiding you. And it's sort of like they're treating you almost as equals, as in they're giving you information as well as advice on how you can approach making music, improving your own instruments, your technique, musicality, as well as sort of music as a career, not necessarily classically as well, just in general, because being a musician isn't just you playing an orchestra, it's not one specific thing, and it is quite interesting to see that being developed because, again, I had like no prior insight into music education at all before then, and then now that I've gone into sixth form, it's even different as well. So it's quite interesting to see that sort of not necessarily balance, but the difference and the contrast between those two sides of music education.
Something really interesting that's come through what both of you said there. I'm going to ask you in a minute, Emma, what do you think about this? But there was something there about being treated as equal, or you know, being treated as a musician, and this idea of being treated as a musician. That seems to be really important in both of those experiences. Something really interesting that you said there as well about music not just being one thing, and lots of different facets of music that's coming through as well. I don't know, Emma, do you have anything that you want to add?
I just think the attitudes are different between extracurricular and within school, because my introduction to it was a very negative thing. I just think of Music Stop, which was just community run, and also Dark Peak, sort of, it's a band organisation, and I had lessons as well, lessons outside of school, and that was my only knowledge of musical education. It's definitely quite
through just loads of Googling and asking people, I found an email of someone who works at Brighter Sound, and me and my mum just sent her an email and was just like, hi, this is the situation, how can you help? And this was just before lockdown started as well. So at that time, they were doing a lot of things online, and that was my first introduction to her. Finding it was just, should you say, almost luck, because through Brighter Sound as well, I found another organisation called Global Grooves, and that's why I did a different project with them. And that was also non-Western music. So it's sort of, I've had an approach to Western music, and now we've gone to like South Africa, Cuba, atonality, and different temperaments. But it's sort of one of those things, you just find someone, or you come across it, and that just leads one thing into another.
Yeah. So I love the way that you Googled, and then that's been your pathway. That's amazing, isn't it? Because you know, there's so much stuff that you can find, or maybe not, maybe you can't find stuff. But there's something key there about people, isn't there?
Yeah, you know? I feel like networking in the music community, and just in general, within music, networking is sort of a key thing. And you could argue with any sort of career, just in life, the more people you know, the more people you can ask about things, because you never know, they might just know something that you need, or know someone who knows something you need. And sort of through those little pockets of music that I found, I almost have somebody to go to for any little thing within music, because like I said before, it's like a massive thing. It's not condensed into just one art form, should you say. It's not like just performance or just playing in an orchestra. So, yeah.
You were nodding there, Emma, do you agree?
Yeah, definitely, because my teacher for the choir when I was younger, she had to catch into the ballet, and she started her own music, and she had work experience that, but then had lessons with them, and then like details of things about vocation, because there weren't other people in my area.
Interesting. Yeah, so you experienced that same thing that came through our data, that you know, if you don't have, or your teacher moves or something, there isn't an interview.
I had that as well.
You did?
Because I had trombone, and I had a teacher for a bit, and then I went for a while without any teacher because just couldn't find a teacher. Mm-hmm. So yeah, networking is very important.
I want to ask you a fairly difficult question, but I'm going to ask it you and leave you to think about it, and then I'm going to invite some questions and comments from everybody else. But I'm just really interested, so I've kind of presented the policy. This is what the policy is saying, that you know, that we should be opening up opportunities for young people, whatever their background, to access good, high quality music education. So that's what the policy is trying to do. But your experience is really interesting, isn't it? Because your musical education has come from outside that, and you've got different experiences of school as well. So I'm going to ask you, we'll have some questions, and then I'll come back to it. I'm going to ask you, what if you could sit down with the government, what would you say to them about music education? what would be the one thing, based on your experience, that they really need to do to actually really give the opportunities to young people? So you can have a bit of think about that. And it might be too, you know, you might not know, but have a little think. Okay, should we have some questions? David, our lovely David Hall, up here.
Thanks very much, Jenny Palace. It's really fascinating. Yeah. I was really interested in the young people's voice. And I mean, if you don't want to answer it, I completely understand. But I would love to get some ideas from you. What would be your ideal music class, for example? What would you like to have that you feel hasn't been given?
I think what I would want most in the music class is class with students who are like also really like interested in passionate, because nothing's worse than being sitting in a GCSE music class where the rest of the students just don't care about the subject and only doing it for a free GCSE or whatever. And so they're like messing about and like they're trying to fiddle about it while you're trying to listen to what the teacher's saying. So I think what I would want in a perfect class would be full of students who are also really passionate about it and want to learn.
You were nodding there, Emma.
Yeah, I agree. In GCSE, there's a lot of. I think the change from GCSE to A levels is that you do have students who are passionate about the subject and you want to be there. But also, I think I've never had lessons in composition. We were never taught. Well, that's all in lockdown. Things changed, so we didn't really get given a brief.
Could I follow up? That's
yes,
really
absolutely.
Fantastic. It's something that struck a lot of us as well. It's very interesting that quite often for GCSE and A level, if you're learning an instrument or singing, you know, or drum kit, so you're given lessons, but yet composition is a really big part of both GCSE and A level, and yet the IB individual lessons never, it's very rare in my experience, and that seems to be a real problem, doesn't it?
I'm going to bring Adam in a moment to respond to that. But Andrew, do you have anything to say about that?
I mean, I would just echo what you just said, like, being in a room with people who don't really care about the subject, or, let's say, don't have as big a passion as you, can sort of be almost a barrier sometimes, because if you think about it, the teacher has to teach everyone. Everyone isn't at the same level. If everyone was at the same level, then it would be much easier, and it wouldn't be really as challenging, and it would be really just easier to teach and easier for you to just learn stuff. But because there's so many people at different levels, like in my music class, there are people who are really passionate about it, people who are amazing musicians, know so much theory and can just analyze things on the spot. But then there's also people who barely know how to what a perfect cadence is, or what a major chord is, or something of the sort. And it makes teaching sometimes a bit disjunct. And in that case, it can really be just a barrier, because you have to sit through being taught something you already know, or having explained over and over again. And sometimes, in some ways, I almost feel sorry for the teachers, because imagine trying to teach really basic stuff when you're just like, I could be teaching you about all these magical things on music, and I have to be explaining this. And it really is sometimes can be a barrier. Like, I remember there was this one lesson where I literally almost fell asleep. I'm not even joking. I literally almost fell asleep. First, second week of college, and I'm falling asleep in lessons. So.
Let's hope the teacher's not. James got a question. I just wanted, can I ask Evan to respond to the question about composition, because you're a composer, right? So
yeah.
How did you find composition?
Oh.
As in, how did you discover that you...
Oh, right. Not in classroom, just in general.
Yeah.
Right. So tricky one, just...
Because you didn't have it in school, did you?
No. By the time I was doing GCSE comp, I was already having lessons. So, must have been around, like, year 8? Year 8? Yeah, I think year 9 actually. That's when I started composing, and I was just using the limited knowledge I had and just had notation software and started learning. I showed you one of my pieces very long time ago, and since then I just carried on going, and I remember before I had my teacher, I had like lessons with him beforehand, and then I got students and I had a proper teacher, and so by the time GCSE composition went around, I had already had like a portfolio of compositions, and I just submitted something from there.
I was going to say, what was it that enabled you to do that, to discover, to find, you know, what was it? How did you discover that you liked composing?
Just by trying it.
Just being able to try it.
Just by having a computer and having a teacher software and then to experiment.
Having the kit, the equipment,
yeah,
and the space, and the value, I guess, around you. Yeah, great. Jane?
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Jennie, for your talk. And thank, thank you, panelists, for your contributions. The question that Jennie asked you, what would you say to the government if you could sit down with them, was really the question I was going to ask as well, though I'd have phrased it slightly different. What do you think it would take for the government, any government, to prioritise music making? So that's one, music education. But so you might want to think about that. But my other question is actually following up on something that you said, that, you know, what's a barrier is other people not being as passionate as you. What would it take, what is needed, to make everybody as passionate as you about music so that you are all at the same level or at similar levels? So it's really lack of music teaching at the very earliest levels. Okay, thank you.
But you could also, like, some people who might be, like, below other people could feel discouraged by people, other people. Because I've had some people at college talk to me, like, put themselves down when talking to me. And it's horrible. I just have to remind them that they're also, like, a really good musician, you know. We have some really, really good musicians out of college, but they just don't realise it because they compare themselves.
We have this natural inbuilt thing as human beings to constantly compare ourselves to other people, don't we?
Yeah.
That could be a real barrier to some people. Yeah.
I mean, I would say that's a bit of a tricky question in my opinion, because it sort of underlines not necessarily a fault, but just a flaw in the educational system as a whole. Because if you're saying just about music and music education, this is education as a whole, we can't just change one part of it without changing the rest of it, because the rest of it will affect it. So we're sort of, this is the underlying thing, is just the educational system as a whole. And I mean, I haven't had much experience with it because I was home educated, but sort of from the experience that I've had and the experience that I heard from other people, a lot of it is literally that teacher-student relationship and the fact that students, they're not asked for input about what they're being taught, what they want to be taught, and that sort of just leads to just you sitting in a classroom and just being like, why am I being taught this? What's the point? And I said that for me feels like a flaw in the educational system, especially when we talk about music education as well.
I like that answer, because I was going to kind of follow up that up by saying, do you think that every single person should be as fired up as you about music? That's quite a difficult question. That would be an interesting question for me to ask all of you, actually. But that's a lovely answer, that you can't just change one aspect of education. You need to change the whole of education. I've got, do you want to come back? I've got a question there and a question there. Do you want to?
I'll be really quick. I was just thinking about the way that children are given drawing equipment and painting equipment really incredibly early on, but they aren't necessarily given things to make music with. They don't have to be formal instruments. And I wonder, I was interested in you saying how you made your discoveries. It was because you had the computer, you had the software, you had the relevant equipment. And so in some ways it's about making, children don't have opportunities to make music unless they've got something to make music with, or their voices are, as you said, are seen as something that is capable of making music, not just noise. I'm going to shut up now.
Okay, so this might be a question that you might also have to think about when it's like your classmates, colleagues, etc. Have you ever had concerns about what genre of music or kind of instruments in particular you might? might be interested in when it comes to how you might be able to take them further? Because like I'm quite, it seems like there's a lot of provision for classical instruments and classical like genre. But if you have a musical interest that lies in any other lane, do you feel like that is sufficiently well taken care of in the school system?
I mean, in our year particularly, we have a lot of like jazz and pop sessions more than classic. So I think when it comes to genres, there is quite a wide range of genres at our college specifically. For example, you and I, we're in the soul band. We're classical musicians, but we're in soul band. You're not in big band, but you come in for concerts in big band and jazz band as well. So there is all these different genres that we do partake in, and I do think that we, if we want to experiment with genres, we have the facilities to at our college. So yeah.
Say that is sort of one of those things we had this conversation at some point. The curriculum and the spec of what we're being taught, especially like at GCSE, less or A level, but still exists, is a barrier in some cases, because if you're really passionate about a subject, the curriculum isn't going to cover your passion. Mm-hmm. If we're going to be honest, like I'm also really into science and biological sciences specifically, and fields also of epigenetics, and that is far beyond the scope of A-level. And in music, I'm also really into sort of mixing, blending other genres, and seeing what we can make through sort of collaboration and sort of improving as a musician, as well as my knowledge. And again, that goes beyond the scope of A-level music. And it's sort of, it is sort of a difficult thing saying, we should listen to students more because you're not going to be able to everyone. This is why like students, especially in music, take lessons outside of school, because school, even in the most perfect environment, isn't going to be able to accommodate everything. And is that a flaw in the educational system, or is that just a fact of life? Well, life. A fact of education, should you say. But yeah.
Yeah, well, we're not even in our A-level curriculum, we're not even doing like 20th century contemporary classical. So
I play recorder, contemporary recorder. You don't touch it.
Yeah, we just like when they get past 1850, it stops there.
The music stops at 1850.
Yeah. But I think this is interesting because I think unlike potentially more complicated science, I don't think this does necessarily fall out of the realm of, or should fall out of the realm of medical potentially. But I mean,
it's quite a controversial thought, so if A-level music disappeared, it might be more emancipating than more of a barrier. That's a thought, isn't it? That's something really interesting. So if there was no A-level music, you might be able to do the music that you want to do.
Yeah, but then maybe less, there'll be, if there was no A-level music, there would be less musicians, but the musicians that they were would probably be more passionate, if that makes sense. Because music A-level is an entry point for people who want to become a musician, but it's not something you can, if you go into it from a higher level, it might stop you from wanting to use it because it's grueling.
Lovely, interesting. It's really, really interesting take. Yeah. So I've got Madison and Adam, and probably we'll probably need to wrap up after that.
This is my question. I was just really struck by what you were saying. So I've got an 8-year-old daughter who's now been in school for like 2 years, and already after 2 years, I'm lucky to have too much time to think about this, but I can see her natural curiosity as you have as a 4.6-year-old is being taught out, and I can see that after 2 years, and what you're saying about what school gives you, that's a whole other big thing. But my question is more about the thing that seems to come up a lot is around value. And you talked about your peers, how they value or don't value music, and you talked about government valuing or not valuing. And I was really struck in Ireland, they just introduced this thing where there's a salary being paid for artists just because you're an artist, not for doing anything, but you're just paid because you say you're an artist. And that's a real value, which is quite extraordinary. And this is a sort of question for Jennie, I guess. We tend to blame the government. We talk about the 20 years of inaction, and we say, well, it's the government, they don't value, they're all kind of idiots, they don't value. But in a way, they're just reflecting what the country wants them to do and say. And I just wonder how much kind of international connection is there in terms of this research. You know, we look at countries like Germany and go, wow, how amazing everybody values music, but maybe that's just our misperception.
Yeah.
And maybe this is a question you perhaps can't answer, but are there places we look to, we see our system as a bit broken in terms of music education, are there places we go, well, actually, you look at Finland, you look at Germany, it works much better, or is that just us projecting our ideals onto somewhere that doesn't actually exist?
It's a great question, Matt. And through that research, there was a whole theme on value, and it was really interesting, and I have, you know, this has been framed in a very particular way, hasn't it? But of course, government mirrors society, society mirrors government, etc., etc. And the data on value is really interesting. That is going to be the next publication when somebody invokes an extra 5 hours in the day to write that. I need to get that out. But the question of value is really, really important. And you know, it comes through all of your comments. There's an implicit value that you have, and that your people around you have, that your teachers have, and the question of value being a barrier. If music's not valued, then a parent is not going to, you know, drive their child 40 miles to access something. And if they do value it, then there is. So it's a really, really complex question. The international perspective is really fascinating, because we do have certain perceptions of different countries, and oh, look at that country, their system is great and music's really valued. But then when you sort of go there and you work there and working with researchers, it's quite a different story. So Germany is quite an interesting example. I've got a colleague who set up the first community music MA programme in Germany. It's really led to community music scholarship in Germany. The question of value in that context is really interesting, because pockets of the society might value music, but only certain music is valued, and that's a whole other thing. And you know, the question of value is so important to think about. So yes, I can put up some research if you'd like to look at them. I mean, I've been able to, if other people have been to Scandinavia, Scandinavian countries, you know, I've been to Sweden and Norway, spent some time in Sweden actually going to different schools, and it's interesting the way the curriculum is framed in those countries. And music is very much more than just music. It's about movement and it's about activity. So, yes, looking at the policy, but the policy values music in certain ways by what it puts in the curriculum. The curriculum places value on a particular music, but actually that is what's causing you all barrier, because you've got different interests and ideas. So it's the life's work of the educationists. Great. Okay, it'd be just lovely to carry on this conversation, but I think we should finish up, and we're going to finish up by hearing from you. So what would you say, what would be the one thing that would where you can frame it in Jane's way, or you can frame it in my way, you know, what would you say, or what would be needed? Yeah.
I think what I was thinking about it is what needs to change mostly is in like the key stage 3 level of it. So a drastic change would be get rid of the GCSE, because immediately having it as a exam changes the dynamic of music education completely. And what would be preferable is like a way of having like something in the classroom in like a one-on-one way. And the like main priority of that is to try and guide the student to have that passion for music, because you can't teach someone like a passion for music. You need to guide them in that way. And if it doesn't work, then you continue on. But if it does work, that means A-level classes will be full of students a lot more impassioned, a lot more like ready to learn and study, and then like how the A-level would have to change as well for that if the GCSE would change like that. And I'm not sure how it would change. It would change more reactively to how the students work.
Fascinating, controversial to come into an education institution and say music shouldn't be examined. But scrap the GCSE, that's a really interesting perspective. Thank you, Adam. Henri, Emma.
I would say sort of echoing what Adam said, as in like having music as an exam thing, especially at GCSE level, as in like 14 to 16, is a bit dumb, to say the least. And so two things which I would tell the government to do, should you say, would be listen to the people who are doing that thing right now. So if they're like currently doing A-levels, currently doing GCSEs, and listen to the people who have done it and now are taking actual careers and professional pathways within those specific things, and ask them what would have helped in making the A-level, the GCSE, or just music education not just more accessible, but more practical and useful to you as a musician in developing your career and guiding your passion. Because the way it's sort of done now is just very one-sided. This is it. End of.
Great, so another vote for scrapping the assessment for the
exam. But examining music is fine at like a level which you already aren't passionate about it. It's different, but examine it at that GCSE level where you may not necessarily have that passion, it's quite counterproductive. Mm-hmm. If not counterproductive, not very productive.
Music as a subject if you don't know what you're going to do with it. For example, a lot of
first gone between something else, but it's his fourth subject, and yeah, it's just knowing what to do with it after, even if you are really passionate about it.
Mm. Yeah, our career opportunity people, when I talk about careers, they never talk about music.
Exactly.
It's always about like engineering, STEM stuff.
Yeah.
If that occurs, all about music and all you do in music, I'll be making all
I feel like the sort of community music side of it is sort of more enlightening in that sense, because the sort of conventional music A-level GCSE university sort of, I say lesser university, but definitely at A-level, it's sort of, you know less about what you're doing.
Yeah, I've only recently started considering going to uni just because I enjoy music so much and I think it would be a good career, but I just don't know anything about, you know, careers, because in my own careers in GCSE, I started mentioning music and I said something about biology and I was interested in that and just focused on that entirely.
Mm, that's really interesting. So the careers advanced in schools don't have the knowledge to advance in. That's great. I just got an email from one of our sister conservatoires. They're doing a careers in music day. So I'll forward the email to Jenny and you can ask her.
Or you can come to our In the Hot Seat series that we run.
Maybe you could answer the question that they just answered.
Maybe me?
Yeah,
well, do you know what? I agree with Omri that they have to listen to the people who are doing it. They've got to listen. And, you know, it is a really difficult question because I hear the argument for music not being an examination subject and not being part of the curriculum. But the other side of that is school is the only place where young people are guaranteed a music education if it exists in schools and if it's good.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the only place that all children go, and I'm saying so that is the only place where it's guaranteed a music education. And I think that, you know, that what's coming through really strongly from you know, all of my experience as well as my research, is this real defensiveness about what you do. There's the compartmentalisation of music education. We're all fighting for the same bit of funding, so that makes us very defensive over what we don't want to give our trade secrets away, we don't want to give our key pedagogies away, because we want the money to do the stuff. And there's also a real problem, I think, I was talking to you about this, wasn't I, about passing people on. So you find that there are organisations, teachers, etc., that will hold on to great students because they're great and you want to work with them and you want to teach them, whereas actually that student needs the next opportunity. And so you see a lot of this territorialness and defensiveness, and I think that's grown out of the marketplace that is music education at the moment. We're fighting for funding. We need to demonstrate how excellent we are. We need to demonstrate the impact of what we do. So we need to keep kids with us that are doing great so we can demonstrate that impact.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that it'd be really easy for me to say, wouldn't it, well, let's just scrap it and just restart something. But I think that what the key thing that is needed is to listen to the research, because of all the work that I've done internationally with governments on their national curricula, writing curricula, designing curricula, writing teacher training packages internationally, I've done very little of that work in my own country. Proudly being part of Michael Gove's The Blob, those teacher educators who, this is back 10 years or so ago, the suspicion of government about anybody in teacher education because of the suspicion of what they're doing, what they're educating, who they're educating. I think that the government have got to start looking properly at research. They hear sound bites, they pick sound bites out, these make it into documents, and you kind of think, where's the substance behind that? Where's the rigour of the research underneath that? And there's a lot of great research that doesn't make it outside of desk drawers. You know, it's given. So we've got to find a way of opening up that dialogue
So summary, don't polish, but let me write it.
Yeah. Why not?
I like it.
Not me. to introduce you, but I understand that Larry did that. So he sent me an email saying, do you think you could please thank everybody, give them a round of applause and remind people about next week. So can we do that first? Thank you, all of you. Research into the effects of music. So you see, this is somebody who's interested in music's effects, so not looking at it from the point of view as performers and composers, but what can music do for people who don't necessarily identify as musicians. And she says, the range of ways in which music can affect the human mind are increasingly investigated and demonstrated. Interdisciplinary approaches can be especially valuable, bringing together ideas, expertise, and methodologies from fields such as music education, music therapy, psychology, new medicine, and neuroscience. So those are all areas you could think about going into if you were interested in music without actually being a professional musician. And she says she outlined a selection of interdisciplinary studies that investigated the effects of music on the human mind and brain, using methodologies from classroom teaching to lab experiments and to DT MRI. So that will be a really interesting talk next week in this room, same place, same time. Please come. Thank you very much.